invite Joe to hang around a little bit longer as I bring up this next panel. You know, we've just had kind of a higher level, a bird's eye view of the of VSRP, the safety culture, and how that applies. But now I want to break it down into a little more local facility level, all right, type view. And to do that, I'm going to bring up my my ride or die, if you will. She has been with me. She worked with me on Recurrent training. She's very creative. She's just fantastic all around. She is a supervisor out of St. Louis TRACON. Please welcome Bethany Bohnenstiehl.
I am invincible, unbreakable, unstoppable, unshakable. They knock me down, I get up again.
So yeah, as Richard said, safety culture will be a part of Recurrent training. Some of you have probably had this training already. The rest of you, don't worry, you'll get it here in the next few months. This is for the instructor-led portion. And we've been doing this for a while now. We gotta say it's our favorite round. We felt that Recurrent training needed to go over safety culture in part because of the massive changeover that we've had with employees. You think about how many new people have come in since we last really discussed it. So here we are, and also just the fact everybody can use a review because we're all human. So we're going to bring some people up to talk about how we can maintain a healthy safety culture at the local level. So first, Joe, he's already up here. He's our FAA Director of Safety. I want to welcome Thomas Gordon. He is the acting XO at SoCal TRACON. Next, we have Alex Cisneros, the SoCal facility representative. And last but not least, we have Mike Taylor, who is the NATCA lead for Partnership for Safety.
All right. I appreciate y'all being here. I said we're gonna take a local look at this, a local level look, all right? So let's go to SoCal, all right, Thomas, Alex. Talk to us, and we realize your facility's not perfect, but talk to us about some of the successes and challenges you've had as you've incorporated safe culture into your facility.
You know, Richard, I think the biggest thing, the backbone of our safety culture is our local safety council. SoCal does a really, really good job of prioritizing it, ensuring that we get as much participation as possible. We all have staffing challenges, we're well aware of it, but we make it a priority to get as many people involved as possible, and it increases safety in our facility by leaps and bounds. We're continuously talking about safety and bringing the issues to the forefront. There's no issue that we're not willing to address and discuss and come up with solutions to.
Okay, Alex, you agree?
I absolutely agree. I think that not only a local safety council, but we have a very robust pilot outreach program where we have people like Rob Reddick, our local safety lead, go out and to the field, to different airports throughout Southern California and brief pilots on the importance of using the NAS and working with air traffic control. We do a great operation rain check as well, where it's bringing that information to aviators throughout Southern California.
Okay, so you're communicating with the local pilot groups, how does that outreach increase your safety culture?
Sure, so having that two-way communication is important. I think that everything that we do has to be based on collaboration, but not only collaboration with amongst ourselves, but with all the users as well. So bringing people into our facility or having people from outside of our facility starts a conversation there at the facility amongst controllers. We've had a lot of these Zoom calls where we have 5, 6, 7 controllers like, I want to be a part of it. I want to be able to explain to the user some of the challenges that we face at work.
So
I was going to say to tack on to what Alex is saying, our airspace is, we deal with VFR pilots nonstop. So a lot of that, we're getting that outreach so we could educate them on what to do in our airspace, where to go, where to exit. It's protecting our controllers, it's protecting our airspace, and it's protecting the pilots. It's a really great program. I just wanted to throw in a little bit extra there for that.
Well, I mean, not for nothing, but y'all make it sound pretty easy, right? Like, and whatnot. Are you having difficult conversations, or is you just see eye to eye on everything?
We definitely have difficult conversations, but that's what leaders do. You know, we're all leaders, we're all in leadership positions, and we're willing to have those conversations. And we're willing to have the not difficult conversations. If we're always communicating, it doesn't really matter. It's a communication piece. We're on the same page. We know we're going to end up on the same page, and that's a big token to our collaboration in that facility.
I think it's important also to highlight that those difficult conversations aren't only between management and the union. A lot of those times, those difficult conversations have to happen union to union. Sometimes you have to talk to your one of your members and have that difficult conversation on how to make things better, on where we might be failing or where we could use help or work. And that's probably the better choice of words there.
Okay.
So, Mike, I want to ask you about the Partnership for Safety, especially at the local level. How does that play into forming a good safety culture and just improving things? You can use your facility or other examples that you might know.
Yeah, sure. So the great part about local safety councils is it's your opportunity to be the change that you want to see. And I think that's something that actually Judd Wallace, so I'll call him out because he hates it, but he taught me that in recurrent training, 2015. I remember hearing that, and I remember thinking about at my time where my facility was at, and there were just things that I wanted to see and see if they could be different. And instead of waiting for somebody else to do it, I wanted to take it upon myself to go and try it out. And that's what the local safety council does. So it's your option, your chance to be that change and make that happen the way you want to see it. So the way it plays into your facility, kind of like we were just talking about, is it gives you the opportunity to set that standard. Instead of waiting for somebody else to do it, you can go in and be the guy that has the uncomfortable conversation. The safe discussions, right? I know Great Lakes knows I like my safe discussions face-to-face. they get tired of hearing me say it. But nonetheless, being the person that goes into that conversation, and this is a piece for you that you can take back to your facility right now, going into that, and instead of being the guy or the lady that's upset about that, be the participant. Sharing that institutional knowledge that you have in those conversations can really change the way somebody new or fresh into the facility, they'll view things. So it really is an opportunity, one, to fix what's going on in your facility, but also to look at other things. So when we're talking about pilot outreach, DuPage is a prime example where they were able to take what they saw was the biggest challenge in their facility, which was their student pilots. They were able to reach out and bridge that gap. And by having those conversations and starting a program, they were able to mitigate a lot of the issues they were seeing. So it really is, I think, it's a cyclical thing where you take the ATSAP like they just talked about with the ERC, when people are submitting those ATSAPs and you are getting them at the local safety council level, you're able to pivot change, and that encourages people to bring up more issues. So,
Under Partnership for Safety, talk to me about the ATSAP briefing sheets. The month of, where do those come from, and what is the expectation?
So when the ERC is evaluating what's current and what's happening, they'll go ahead and the ATSAP will create these monthly discussions that you should all be having face-to-face. But what they'll do is take current issues, and then you at the local safety council will go and brief all operational personnel once a month. But it's also an opportunity for you to incorporate local issues at your level. Or what's going on at your facility. And I apologize, I missed conversation.
Good.
All right, so that is what it is discussing those current issues.
Okay, and one of the things that we said, and I want to reiterate here and give you a chance to speak to it, somebody in the last panel mentioned checking that box to share with your local safety council.
So you have the option, when you're filling out an ATSAP report, there's a box on there that says to share a de-identified report with your local safety council. So if anyone's heard the phrase like, oh, my ATSAP doesn't do anything, which hopefully they've changed your mind on in the last panel, it does. There's a lot of things going on. But if you share that narrative with your local safety council, they're able to see and get context that they wouldn't otherwise have. And with that, if you're on the LSC, if you're taking those, again, going back to that other point, it will cause you to feel like you should continue to report because your ATSAP is doing something. You are seeing actual change at your local level instead of having it sent out into the ether.
And speaking of which, you gave, when we talked about this before, that you're talking about Columbus and their shades issue, speaking of taking it a lower level.
Yeah, so for instance, some people are really, well, most people I think are really familiar with filling out a safety event, and that can take a little time because you're filling out all the causal factors and whatnot and the contributing factors. But a safety problem, when we go up into the tower at Columbus, we're an east-west stop, so we're blind in the morning, we're blind at night, right? And I found out later on that some of your towers have dual shades. Our tower did not have dual shades. So what we did is we started ATSAPing, hey, we can't see out the window. And when we started doing that, we were able to get from the ERC, they saw it was a problem, they were able to implement a fix, which is getting that dual tower shade. So something that small, something that really, it's just an annoyance at your facility or you talk about a little bit and complain about in the break room. Everybody complains about stuff in the break room or in the operation. Those items, fill those out as safety problems. If they are really safety problems, you can do that. That will roll back either through the ERC or if it's something you can mitigate at the local level, that's what your LSC is gonna find and they're gonna see and they can make changes.
One last thing before I turn it over to Bethany. You were mentioning to us earlier about the going back to the safety brief sheets, the benefit of getting veteran, junior, that discussion, because it is supposed to be a discussion. And listen, I come from a smaller level. See, I'm here to tell you, discussion is we're using that word freely. Tell us about the benefits of that.
So the best part about those safe discussions, if you do them properly, like if we just put them on a cedar, right, you go in, you read it, you're clicking through it, we know that you're not actually taking the time. Let's be honest. That's why they're supposed to be face-to-face. So if Richard has 10 years of experience and Alex only has a year, we can start talking about what's current. Maybe it's VIP movement, I think was the most recent one. Well, now Richard can be like, yeah, it was terrible. The last time we did VIP movement, this is what I do. And it seems like maybe Richard's complaining or he's a little upset about something, but really he's passing off that knowledge. So I know at my facility, sometimes you get some of the older crowd that want to be upset about what's going on. But if you get them past having to sit down on their break and do a briefing, within 10, 15 minutes, they're really sharing knowledge. I think everybody in this room can probably relate to where a conversation started off is maybe just a complaint, and it really turned into something beneficial. We all have those veteran controllers in our mind from when we started into air traffic, those phrases. Like, for instance, Judd's phrase to me about being the change that you want to see. Those moments don't happen unless we're in a room and having that conversation. So really, there's just a huge benefit. Alex may have never seen that in his career yet, but you have, and you can pass that on. We don't have to wait for him to experience something bad before he gets the experience on how to work through it.
Let's not discount the fact that I am naturally angry. So, all right.
Sure.
So
yeah, that's the vibe I get, yeah.
So, Joe, I do have a question. As Director of Safety, what are you seeing being done, and what are you doing personally to enhance the safety culture within the FAA itself?
I think we're stressing the importance of collaboration because I truly do believe that collaborating is the first step in creating a safety culture. At the facility, every single facility I've been at as an ATM, I've built that relationship and I've built that trust with that rep. And that is the rock, right? I mean, the collaboration piece, because you're not gonna solve it alone. And I will tell you, I do it by example, right? I think we're going to 22 districts for ATSAP training, and I wouldn't go without John Murdoch, right, my counterpart. So we're leading by example that we're gonna go and collaborate together and solve these issues.
That's awesome. As you say lead by example, do you also see other members of upper management on both sides leading by example? Are they following the lead, or is this something that we can all do together and eventually turn the ship?
Oh, I think so. I mean, the only thing I can do is, for sure, you have my commitment today that I will continue doing that, and I will lead by example. But I will say, I mean, I see my boss over there. He does the exact same thing. But I see it on both sides, NATCA, FAA, so I'm sure we have the commitment there. So.
If we take that between the be the change that you want to be, I think we'll be in good shape.
We'll get there.
Yeah, so Thomas and Alex, let me ask you, like Joe said, capitalize on that at the local level. How much are you doing together with the outreach, whether, he's talking about visiting other facilities and whatnot. How much face time are you giving the workforce, et cetera, together to reinforce the collaboration piece?
Sure. So that's actually something that I'm very passionate about, being able to engage with the workforce. For a long time, SoCal TRACON had a very healthy team brief cycle. And before the pandemic, we would meet every single day. There was always a crew that would meet and have conversations, just like he mentioned. And those conversations, they matter. They matter. So we just made an agreement and a commitment that we're going to re-engage in those conversations starting next Tuesday. We're going to start team briefs. Unfortunately, in our staffing situations, it's difficult. But we are going to make the best of it. We're going to do it 2 to 3 times a day, make ourselves available so we can have these conversations. Specifically, we've been having issues with pilot reports. So we're going to have that. We're going to have that conversations in mid-shift operations, not only to talk to the workforce and for us, it's not for us to tell them, it's for us to hear from them. How can we get buy-in? And that's what we want to create. How can we, as leaders, get their help in getting our facility to a better place?
Yeah, absolutely. That engagement is huge. And the pandemic's affected everybody, but looking at where we're at now and being able to get to our team brief cycle back, it's such a huge part of SoCal TRACON. So it's a huge benefit to everybody getting that back. It's been a few years now, or at least a couple years now, and it'll be good. I know the supervisors are excited. The crews are looking forward to getting back together and communicating. So yeah, we're looking forward to it.
You said something interesting there, and I want to open it up to everyone, the concept of the trust and the collaboration. How about on your level, Joe or Mike? Where do you see that?
So I'm a firm believer that strong sponsors create strong local safety councils. So if you're a facility rep or you're an air traffic manager, if you don't believe in it, it's hard for the rest of your facility to believe in. However, if you're somebody who's on that local safety council, or even if you're not, you're just kind of interested in it, it's hard to get buy-in if you're not playing the part. Talking about partnership for safety, partnership sounds great. It means that it sounds like we're all in it, but sometimes you have to be the one that starts that conversation. You're the one that has to build that relationship before people actually buy in. So if it feels like maybe that's not happening at your facility, be that person to engage. If you're a facility rep and you feel like we need more support from your manager, talk to your manager. Hey, where do we see our facility? What do we see it look like? What does safety culture mean at SoCal? Well, it should mean that we should make time and investments. We know that staffing's hard. I don't think there's a single person in here that doesn't work at a 6-day work week facility. So it's difficult, but the fact is we can't afford to not and make that investment, and it really does depend on both parties investing fully into it. So.
Thomas, I got to work with you in Portland. You did a stint there, which I believe was your second facility.
Correct.
And I know you've moved around a little bit since then. I'm not going to ask you what you're running from, but what I'm more interested in is What's the difference? What's the difference maker in the culture when you go from facility to facility? What seems to be the principal determining factor as to what kind of culture they have?
Just the willingness to engage each other, the collaboration piece. When we worked at Portland, it was getting together with the TRACON, being in a TRACON tower environment in the same confines. It could be difficult at times, but the willingness to get together and have those meetings, have the work groups to be able to put the hot button, hot topic issues behind us and get forward. I think that's a big deal. You really see it at SoCal, where we collaborate on everything. We were, just last week we were in a meeting with Burbank and Van Nuys airports, are two closely located airports, and there was 30 people in this meeting. We had controllers, we had supervisors, we had OMs, we had our traffic management unit. It was just, you start seeing the willingness to collaborate and come up with solutions. So.
I think that's important what he said. You have to lead by example. If you really believe in collaboration, you have to lead by example. And that means creating a relationship, with management, with the workforce, to be able to have those conversations and push down what you're trying to do.
You know, I appreciate that. As you say that, I'm thinking about the last transition of air traffic managers that we had, and the current one, it took him a little bit longer to get out to the workforce. And so there was that piece for quite some time, like, this individual doesn't even know my name or that I work here. I could be anybody. And there was that lack of trust for quite some time.
Sure.
So I appreciate that. Let's take some questions.
Yeah, I'm gonna direct this towards, well, any of you, but really Thomas and Alex. The question from the audience was, what is your greatest challenge to develop a safety culture locally? If we want to say, like, what would be the greatest challenge that we face, every facility would face, to develop a healthy safety culture?
Say the greatest challenge is getting people to see eye to eye. But once you start to really peel back the layers of an issue, it all boils back down to safety. And if both sides are trying to be as safe as possible, we're going to find common ground. So a lot of times that is the biggest challenge, is seeing eye to eye. But the constant communication and working on it always seems to prevail.
I personally think people are stressed, right? I mean, they're working 6-day work weeks, like you mentioned. And I think it's important when people go into the operation, even if you're having a rough day, right, you go in with a smile on your face, because that's what I tell all the managers. If you go in angry and upset, it's going to be contagious throughout the workforce. And that is what starts the culture inside that operation. So even if you're having a bad day, go in smiling, put it to the side. But I think right now, the stress, you know, the 6-day work weeks, I mean, people are tired, right? And we have to acknowledge that. So help reinforce that positive energy.
I think being able to go to the workforce and acknowledge, just like he said, the work they do. 99.9% of the time we do amazing work. There are some situations where there is room for improvement, but by acknowledging the workforce and having empathy with the workforce and understanding the challenges, I think that provides an environment where we become stronger and safer.
So you're saying the only time you hear from Thomas and the leadership team is not when something goes wrong, but you know it's a constant ongoing thing. And I think too often, most of us, that's the only time we hear from them.
Yes, in order to have a healthy relationship, a relationship can be based just on difficult conversations. A relationship's based on everything else as well. So yeah, we talk to Thomas, I talk to our ATM, Dale, on a daily basis, whether it's, hey, how was your weekend? How's the family? You know, stuff like that, back and forth. We know what's going on. But relationships matter, and relationships are built not just you have to have a relationship established before you get into the serious and difficult conversations.
It's hard to have a meaningful discussion with somebody you don't have a relationship with, I think is the gist of it. And that does start by asking those other things. But yeah, I think all those things are great, but I think the greatest challenge really is making sure that people, one, that we provide the time, but that they see that extra effort's worth it, right? It's hard to do more than we're already asked to do. When you're stretched thin and you've worked 10 hours that day, you aren't necessarily apt to report a safety problem. But if I know that if I report it, he's gonna take care of it, and I know it's gonna get to that LC and it's gonna come back around, I'm more apt to do those things. So I think there is that buy-in piece, but the relationship, again, it has to be there. That's how we collaborate.
Yeah, so one of the questions popped up, how do you get management and FacReps to utilize the local safety council more? I know that it does differ from facility to facility, right? So Mike, Joe, what do you think?
I think you gotta empower your people, and you gotta learn to stop micromanaging, right? I mean, that's why you have a local safety council, to sit there and give recommendations to your leadership team, meaning the ATM and the FacRep, right? Stop micromanaging them and let them do their job, plain and simple.
would say to that, Joe and John do a great job of those things. Like when we come to them as a group, they're really good about equipping and releasing. I know that if I need something, I can call John and Joe, and they will take care of that. And I think that should cascade all the way through, down to the person that's submitting it. Knowing that I have that support will make me more apt to do those things. So I think the reality is if you're a facility rep or your ATM, you don't have time to do all these things, and you need to leave it to those experts. I'm the one working that operation, and the supervisors in that operation, let us do all that work. I mean, practically anything you encounter at your facility could go to the local safety council for a collaborative work group. It's there. It just needs to be utilized. And I think it's up to the LSCs, too. If you're on that LSC, it's your responsibility to show value. If people are giving you time to do something, you have to show that that time is worth it. And I think that all goes back, whether it's the sponsors and equipping and releasing, or you're down to the LSC.
Thomas, Alex, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but do you have anything that your LSC is working on currently, or some recent successes that you've had?
Ooh, we've had a lot of successes with our LSC. Currently, right now, we're working on getting NOTAMs disseminated to the workforce on our NOTAM page. There was, you know, being at such a large facility, we have six different areas plus our traffic management unit and, you know, the plethora of airports underneath. We have 26 towers. So getting all of our NOTAM and pertinent information disseminated to the entire facility, because when you look at it, this area talks to this area, they're transferring planes back and forth to each other. So if this area doesn't know what's affected at that airport, we're seeing issues. So that's one thing that we're working on right now. It has been getting a little bit of the spotlight put on it by Rob. He's our local safety lead. So it's one of those things that it's kind of at the forefront right now.
Do I understand you correctly? You say your local safety council might be over enthusiastic? No, I know Rob, and Rob does a great job.
All right. Another thing we're working on also is pilot reports on how to get the workforce to disseminate and get the pilot reports in a more consistent manner. And a ton of procedural issues. He mentioned Van Nuys, Burbank. I mean, it's a very complex operation there in the Burbank area with two major airports that final approach courses cross each other off the departure end. So that's been a conversation that we've had for the last 10 years, and we're starting to finally get some momentum through the work of the local safety council and Dan Massey, who sits on that. So I think it's paying dividends, again, through hard and difficult conversations and subjects.
But I think you hit on something really important there, and it's the fact that these things take time, right?
It does take time. We're in the agency, and unfortunately, just things take time, and we want to do it right. Anything that we don't want to rush into these things because they matter. So it takes a lot of conversation. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of leadership, and it takes having the right users or the right people in the room to be able to foster that conversation.
Joe, Mike, I saw you both react when he said it takes time. Did you want to add to that?
It does. I mean, you just got to have patience, right? And don't give up. You're going to have those crucial conversations, and you're going to get really angry. But just, again, learn from it, move on, and just keep moving. When you stop, that's where the problems start. So don't give up.
Yeah, I think that's been my biggest lesson this last year in this role, is that nothing happens quickly, but that I think to some degree is by design. When you're rushing through things, you're just going to miss it. But something else that you mentioned, which I think is important too, you gotta have the right people for the right job, right? We gotta make sure that we're picking the best people that really do care. They are gonna invest. They are gonna be the safety nerd at your facility that's gonna annoy you and hound you to do those reports. But it's important because they're the ones that are gonna produce that. And you really do need both perspectives. We've made changes or tried to make changes in the past at my own facility, and we thought it was great as controllers. It was awesome. We're like, yeah, we're definitely do this. And the soup's like, you're going to kill us. You can't do that. And we wouldn't have known. And we would have been really happy with what happened initially. But having that other pieces in there is important, too. And that's why the people that we do choose, we need them to give that input, because really the secret ingredient to local safety councils is you, whoever's in it and who's on that. You really have that expertise and knowledge. So.
That brings us to the conclusion. We're out of time, but I appreciate your expertise and your time here. As we exit the stage, I'll bring up my co-moderator, Dawn Johnson. We'll go this way. She's over there. And turn the time over to Dawn.